Please welcome to the program, Masai Ujiri!
How are you, sir?
How you doing, man?
Nice to see you.
You're doing all right?
Welcome.
Thank you.
Thank you.
How you doing?
I'm good, good.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
This is fun, right?
Yeah, it's pretty cool.
You know, we're very excited. Congratulations on the gig, and thank you so much for turning it around.
Thank you. We're trying. We're trying hard.
You walk into a franchise that isn't just struggling, but a franchise that was... I mean, there were a lot of people questioning what the point of the Raptors was for a long time. What were you looking at? How do you break down this thing?
Well, sometimes, you know, like, teams are going to go through phases, I think, and... the Raptors went through a phase, and obviously we lost a superstar at some point. And I think sometimes when that happens, you're going to struggle a little bit. And I think Brian did a great job in trying to get it back. Sometimes you honestly need a little bit of luck.
Brian Colangelo, he's the man that hired you here as well, didn't he?
Yes, sir. And I worked 3 years for him. And you just sometimes it's hard to put a finger on actually like what goes wrong. You have to pick well. You have to figure out free agents. You have to figure out timing. You know, like, and honestly, there's plenty luck to it. We all sit down and think, wow, geniuses, but there's plenty luck to it. You know?
Well, for people who are watching who may not necessarily even be into sport, the other thing that has to happen is, and this could apply to their business or life, you have to have a paradigm shift. The culture within any organization has to change. And you know that you had walked into a scenario that it was more than just a stretch of bad luck. This was a team that had been trending in a particular way. Mm-hmm. And yes, over the years, this team has had superstars that are no longer here. But how do you change the culture of an organization?
Well, you come in and start to preach something different, you know, like whether it's changing it or starting to do things a different way, because like any other organization, I'm sure even with yours, you know, you come in and you want to do something different. You want to have red chairs, you know, like you want to, that's just the nature of life. And when I came in, you bring a different team in. It's something that I thought was really hard, because some of the people I actually like worked with here. And you have to tell them that, you know what, we can't move forward together anymore. That's tough. And then you have to start instilling some of the things you believe in. And I believe in passion. I believe in honesty. I believe in working hard and giving it your best. I don't believe in excuses. I don't believe in Canada is cold and immigration and all that stuff.
You know? It's cold. Oh, it's cold.
Hey, I'd rather be cold in Canada than cold in a couple other places.
Yeah, fair enough. Yeah,
and that's how I would sell it.
So what you're talking about there is there's a lot of this idea that we can't attract great players to Canada. I know Vancouver, when they had the Grizzlies, thought about this as well. Mm-hmm. Us here, that unless we drafted, we weren't going to be able to attract people based on temperature and taxes and all that other stuff, right?
Well, to me, that's... Can I say crap on
you
your show?
You can say shit. You can say whatever you want. Dude, right now, we're in the playoffs. You say whatever you want, right?
Well, to me, you know, like, that's a load of nonsense in my mind. If we put a brand there on the floor that's winning basketball, like, what a great city, great people. It's cold in how many? I always give the example, Indiana, Memphis, San Antonio, and Miami played with the final four teams in the NBA Finals last year. Miami, we like to go. I like to go maybe once in a while. I'm not a big fan of going there. I'd rather go to other places. Yeah. But out of all those cities, I'd rather live in Toronto.
Yeah,
you know, yes, and they're successful, you know, so... why can't we make... So I have the opportunity now and the obligation to make this basketball team good. And that's going to attract people when you win.
Well, you know, the Blue Jays were able to reach a point. The Expos did it for a while. The Blue Jays took it over. This is Canada's team. Like, this is Canada's team. And I suppose you realize that how much it is, how better it will be if the country embraces it, right? As opposed to just the city.
Yes, I think the country will. The one thing good we have going, I think, is lots of young Canadian players. How about that? 27 Canadian players playing in the NCAA tournament.
And it doesn't hurt when a guy like Andrew Wiggins says he would love to play in Toronto. That doesn't hurt, right?
I wish I could talk about that, but I can't. You're going to be giving me a lot of money to pay the fine. My guy Jim is over here, so he's going, shh, be quiet.
Even before they declare? You can't talk about it when they haven't declared yet?
We can't talk about them till a certain date. So I will not say anything. But I can say this. The 27 Canadian players playing in the NCAA tournament, I think that's, for me, that's phenomenal. And that's the beginning of growth and where basketball is going, I think, is taking off in the country.
Is that a big part of the business for you to try to get Canadian players to play here?
100%. Any way that we can do it, we're going to find talent, you know, like, but to find homegrown talent to me that's why there's a team in Canada, you know, like, and why not take advantage of it when we can?
Right. You know, it's funny, when you got the job and there was this press conference, there was this beautiful moment where you said you're home. Mm-hmm. You feel like you're home. Why is Toronto home to you?
I don't know why it feels like this. I think it's because of the first 3 years I spent here under Brian. Just the way people, I wasn't even in this kind of a position, you know, but the people of MLSE, everywhere I was, I lived in the Soho, everybody just embraced me, you know, like, and met my wife while I was working here in D.C. She came over, moved over here for about a year before I got the job in Denver. So it has like a special place in me. When we came back here, I'm not one of those that's going to be traveling to the States and go live there during the summer or something. We bought a house here. I love it. My baby was born here 3 months ago. It's for me, it's incredible to me.
You know, and believe me, we're happy you're here. There's an interesting thing, though, and this is, I think, started as well with Brian Colangelo, which is you and him, it's not just about grabbing players from the U.S. It's a big part of your mandate, it feels, to be working hard in other parts around the world.
Yes, you have to.
Tell me about the Giants.
You have to. And the programs we've had and me having the NBA giving me the opportunity to work in Basketball Without Borders was incredible. Where you're doing camps in Africa and just seeing raw talent. I did Basketball Without Borders in South America, and that's where I met Grievous Vasquez when he was 17 years old, you know. So all these things come into play one way or the other, but there's talent around the world now. We're going to find the best talent. If it's in America, we're going to get them here. Whatever, anyhow we can build that that winning brand here in Toronto, we're going to do it. I was just speaking to one of my scouts who is in they're all over the world, you know, like, and you have to capitalize on it, I think, and you have to have your eyes open.
But isn't even, for sure we want that, but isn't it more than that? Because the majority of the people that you scout and the programs you do in Basketball Without Borders and the Giants that you have, you know, in Africa, like, which is the program, not that tall, but most of those guys aren't going to make the NBA, and a lot of those guys aren't going to go into college, but what you're doing, or if they go to college, this is about education, this is about building and life building more than just basketball, isn't it?
No doubt. And that's my heart. That's my homeland. I also have an obligation. I can't be a general manager or president on a basketball team here and not look out for where I came from. I grew up aspiring like these young kids, and somebody has to give them hope, whether it's shoes, whether it's coaching, whether it's opportunity, even seeing NBA players or a T-shirt or a basketball camp, you know, like that's what Giants of Africa wants to do. That's what I want to do. And I cannot fail. That's how I feel. I cannot fail because of them, because of those young kids, because they have to have a platform. And that's the way I look at it.
Where does that come from in you, that connection? Because a lot of people, you know, it's just hard enough to make it in this business. They stay focused on just the job at hand. Where does that idea?
For me, it's just growing up. You know, my dad always told me you have to be honest and you have to treat people the way you want to be treated, and you have to help people. So helping the youth in Africa where there's sometimes not much opportunity. Look, I didn't grow up in the States. I didn't grow up in Canada. I grew up in Northern Nigeria, where it's 90% predominantly Muslim, you know, like, so it's not something where I'm coming and sitting here and talking and I grew up there and I saw them up to when I was 17, 18 years old. So I want to be, I want to help those kids because I saw it growing up where sometimes the little hope you have is this little, you know, like, and you have to capitalize on it sometimes where there's a little window of opportunity. And I have to. For me to be in this position, it's an obligation for me.
They're just doing the celebration this past little while of when the Nuggets beat the Sonics, right? And that, or the one beating eight.
Yes.
And Mount Mutombo, Dikembe Mutombo, just the impact he would have had in, around the world is one thing, but in Africa, I mean, this is him even clutching the basketball the next, like, that's just iconic.
It's iconic. And I'll tell you this. I'll tell you this story. The first time I met Nelson Mandela, we walk into...
first time?
Yes, the first time.
Oh, nice. Couple times. Nice.
No, sorry. I didn't mean it like that. But the first time I met him, I remember we come down in the hotel and it's, I think, six or seven of us going, a couple NBA players, and I'm sitting there with Mutombo and Bob Lanier and Zach Randolph and I think it was Sagana Diop came down and they have their pants sagging and a couple of them had T-shirts on and Mutombo goes, "Where are we going today?" And they both looked at, "We're going to beat Nelson Mandela," and he's like, "Well, go back upstairs and dress like you're going to meet Nelson Mandela." No, it's incredible. And as soon as we walk in to meet Nelson, he was, you're getting old at the time, you know, like he had his walking stick and I was standing on one side with Dikembe and all the other players were on the other side. And he walked over straight first thing to Dikembe Mutombo and he looked at him and looked up and he said, "That's a great thing you're doing for the people of Africa. And don't ever stop. Don't ever stop doing that." And it gave me like goose pimples and I was looking like that. And he looked at me and he goes, "That's a wonderful smile you have, young man." And I was like, "Well, I know I'm not doing anything yet, you know, like, but it gave me like to be in the midst of like two great people." And yeah, Mutombo is not compared to Nelson Mandela, but
still,
yeah,
influence.
$29 million hospital he built, you know, like in his hometown in Congo, taking care of people in a country and a place and a region that has been struck by war and poor people. For me, it's incredible and close to my heart.
Oh, it's true. That's fantastic. How do you get, I know that every generation has their own positive moments and their own ways that they're different from previous generations, but much is made, not just in basketball, but in all sports, that there's a younger generation today that doesn't have that connection to that kind of service. When you even hear about the great athletes in hockey, certainly Mutombo, and because it was so new, the NBA was successful again in the 80s and early 90s. How do you get, like, how important to you is it where your younger players understand that it's more than just winning?
We have to teach them, you know, like we have to teach them. And sometimes these guys don't know, you know, like, and I know sometimes, you know, we say, "Hey, these athletes are paid a lot of money," and they're sometimes we don't know that these guys are 21 years old, 22 years old.
Or they've been sometimes.
Yeah, sometimes younger, 18, 19 years old. They've only been to college maybe 1 year, you know, like, and so. My philosophy, honestly, when I became a GM is, yeah, you get burned sometimes, but how do you mentor them, you know, like, and how do you lead them? I remember I say this with all honesty, in the beginning of the season, I sat down with Kyle Lowry and I said, "Kyle, you know, like, I don't want to see you not succeed, you know, like, for me, for me, I failed, you know, like not only you as a player and on my team, but me as a person and you, when you can be a multi-million dollar player, then you're now a minimum player because of body language or because
attitude or
questioning authority or those little things. Nobody has ever questioned your basketball. How can that part there stop you from taking care of your family for many years. You know, like I spoke to Terrence Ross today, you know, like about how do you control your sleep patterns and get ready for games. And those things, sometimes these guys don't know, you know, like
they're
so young.
Can you talk to me about sleep patterns? 'Cause I don't know.
I can't help you on that one.
but that's, so you have to kind of...
You have to.
Yeah.
In my opinion, some of these guys... Yeah, think about it. Maybe it's a question we ask everybody here, you know, like, what were we doing when we're 21 years old? Yeah. And tell me, if they put $5 million in my hand when I was 21 years old,
yeah.
Good God.
And especially, and like, and not everybody in pro sports comes from, you know, marginalized communities, but many do, right?
No doubt.
Where $5 million is the whole neighborhood.
Exactly.
Yeah,
yeah, exactly. And how do you teach them to manage? How do you teach them to live? How do you teach them to treat people? How do you teach them? They're going from city to city. It's incredible, you know, like, but all we see sometimes is them playing on the basketball court and millions of people watching them. And sometimes they make a little mistake that we would make in normal world. And we understand they're role models. We understand they're in the limelight. But I think maybe sometimes we as mentors and we in management have to look at it and say, hey, you know, like, what are we doing to make them better?
I'm going to ask a couple of questions that I'm sure they're going to cut out of the interview, but it's going to go online. What does Phil Jackson being in with the Knicks change about the East for you?
Absolutely nothing.
Yeah.
No, I'm kidding.
Well, because that guy's going to be able to make that team, attract people to that team.
Yes, I think Phil would do a phenomenal job. I naturally, and please clap after this, I hate the Knicks and
yes.
Don't yes. care, really.
Me too. Okay, so here's another full-on basketball question. When you were going to make that Rudy Gay trade and they agreed, how many seconds were you jumping in the air because you were surprised you were able to pull that off?
Well, I can't. You can't jump in the air until it's done.
Right.
But I was in my office by myself and Jeff Weltman came to join me and I can't comment on it.
So at least 3 seconds. Well, I mean, that's... Who would have thought that you could unload a star in this league and get better? Like, who would have thought?
Well, we tried, and Rudy Gay is a phenomenal player.
He's playing great now.
Yeah, he's playing great now. Just in fit, you know, like, yeah. And it's unfortunate because we thought it could have gone either way, you know, like, we prepared for it either way. Will we go down, you know, like, we were ready for that. Yeah. Will it kind of go up? That's why you kind of heard of all the Lowry trades and all that stuff. We were preparing. Right. Lowry knew, the agents knew. I think communication is a huge part of what we do. But with those things, I told you before, we're talking back there, sometimes luck, you know, like, and so some of us want to claim to be geniuses, you know, like, nah, sometimes it's luck and you just hope that it goes your way and you give them the right platform to perform. So people talk about, you know, like Brian and he did this, he did that. Well, guess what? Brian drafted Valanciunas. Brian drafted Terrence Ross. You know, Brian, I was here with Brian. We drafted DeMar DeRozan, you know, like, so there are good things that, you know, like, brought Dwayne Casey, you know, like, there's so many things, you know, like, just need a little bit of luck. Sometimes there are some things that don't work out very well, like Primo Pasta, but...
Yeah. That didn't work out at all. I love that you said that.
I had to say that, but
yeah.
Can you cut that
out? No. Sorry, Andrea. One of the things that, again, it's another thing that applies to other leadership, you come in, and there's that natural comment about now the coach. People go, what about the coach? Well, the GM wants to bring in his person, however it's going to be, but... You got this coach, and right now it's going well. How real internally is it where a GM knows, I don't want this guy to be my coach?
Well, you know, like, I've known Dwayne Casey for a little bit. I think when you come and you get a job, you just assess it, you know, like, and you evaluate every single part of it, and you see the parts that are not working right away. You see the parts that, you know what, you study it and say, hey, maybe if you give it a chance, it's going to work. And then... you see some of it that, where you say, you know what, no way, you know, it's not, this is not happening. And I looked at Dwayne Casey, you know, like phenomenal person, you know, like great to work with, and he's getting better as a coach. You know, like we all need that chance, we all need that platform. And you know what, when you first get a job, you know, like that, there's that honeymoon period. And I thought, you know, like, why not give Dwayne Casey a try? You know, like he has a philosophy, which is awesome. You know, like he's a defensive coach. You want to have and build an identity. He, you know, like he has that, you know, like, and so how can you build on it? And he's worked hard over the, I think the course of the year, and we'll continue to see how it grows.
Tell me about the Drake factor.
Drake is the best. He's the, it's, I think, bringing him on was, I think, genius on
Because it's more than just promotion.
Yeah, it's
he helps, doesn't he?
No, he does, 100%. You know, like he's a very insightful person. He's very thoughtful. He's very, very smart. The first time I met him, it was incredible. I was like, huh, are you like really talking, you know, like to a rapper or like from, you know, us being stereotypical? Yeah. You just feel like it'll be, he's totally like different, you know, like, and can talk about anything in the world, you know, like, and he's very, he never pretends to know, you know, like he's never going to say, oh, it's his way. If he has to take a moment and think about it, he will. I get all these texts from him, you know, like, and we text back and forth. It's awesome.
Does he give you like trades and drafting advice?
No, but he'll ask me a couple questions. Yeah, he does, and he asks brilliant questions. It's awesome.
How close were we to not being called the Toronto Raptors? There were rumors that team was going to change, and speculation was back to the Huskies. How close was that?
I tell you what. You got Mr. Tim Lawick. He's sitting right here next week. Yeah. Tell him I asked the question.
Yeah? Do you want to know too?
No. Yeah. No, we were in the same room, but he'll answer it better. I think he's the big boss.
Will you get in trouble if you answer it?
No, not really. But I'll let him, I'll put the pressure on him.
I'd like to know how close this team came. Okay, I want to play you a film clip.
Okay.
Not the one about flight, but the other one, and see what this impact it was on you. We need audio.
A midget.
I am Stan.
A magician. A hip DJ. An Arab. An astrologer. And a great big kid. What have you got? It's fish fever. And once you catch it, you're hooked. The fish that saved Pittsburgh. An astrological disco sports extravaganza. And the fish be with you.
The fish in St. Pittsburgh. That trailer, the trailer is borderline racist and uncomfortable to watch now, but did you saw that when you were younger?
Yes, I did.
Yeah?
It's funny, my mom, she didn't know too much about basketball, but she had the opportunity to travel in the medical field to Europe, and she would find anything that had to do with basketball, and the fish that saved Pittsburgh is one of the videos she brought back to me. Like, Dr. J, it was unbelievable.
You watch it all the time?
Yes. Come Fly With Me and all the NCAA, you know, with Hakeem Olajuwon and Faislama Jammer, is incredible growing up.
I think we have a Come Fly With Me clip. It's incredible, right? Mm. Just what Jordan did.
It was a JV game, and I was only 5'8". In practice, I've never been able to get up that high. But the adrenaline was pumping, and I just took off. It all happened so fast, I wasn't quite sure what I'd done. But you know, I just really love that feeling.
Hi, my name is Michael Jordan. I want you to take a trip with me and discover the secrets that I've known for many years, that man was truly destined to fly.
6'6" guards from North Carolina, the number 23.
I tell you what, that's unbelievable, because I sit here and I watch that, and you go to like presidents and GM meetings, and you're sitting in this room and think about how I grew up in northern Nigeria and reading Sports Illustrated or Basketball Digest and seeing all these guys, and then you're sitting across a room and it's Larry Bird and Danny Ainge and Michael Jordan and Pat Riley. And I tell you, like, when I first got the job in Denver, the first time I'd go to those meetings, I'd just be like that. Like you are in awe, because Not only is it them, but I could never even imagine in my whole life that I would actually like be sitting in this situation, and it's real.
And you're trying to beat them.
Yes, and you're trying, and you are trying to, you're trying to beat them. And then they call you, you know, like, and they try to kick your butt.
Have you got a Michael Jordan call yet?
I've spoken to him on the phone twice. Once with Brian Colangelo, and another time with Josh Kroenke. Yeah. Spoken to Larry Bird. I'm really close to Pat Riley. He's a great mentor. I love him to death. And those guys are Danny Ainge. I'm close to too. But the
Danny
way
Ainge played for the Toronto Blue Jays.
Yeah, they're the best. Yeah. You know, like, and for them to embrace me, you know, like in this position and where I come from, you know, like, I think it just shows you the kind of people they are.
The game is changing, and it's so there's a lot of positivity. Tell me about the Jason Collins thing and the impact this is going to have on the NBA.
I think unbelievable. You know, like, what a guy. You know, like, to come out, and that's one of the big things I think I've learned in my life is we travel all these places. You go to all these different countries, and I think one of the things that's wrong with the world now is we don't respect what other people do. You know, like. I went to school in North Dakota. It was best time I had in my life. You know, like, I lived in Russia for a couple months scouting. You know, like, best time of my life.
Bismarck State.
You know, like, if we learn, you know, like that, you know what, ways that certain people live, and this is who they are. It's their culture. You know, like, when you go to there, treat them with respect. You know, like, and respect what they do. You know, like, and sometimes it's tough. I know sometimes. There are people that don't mean well, you know, like, but that's everywhere, you know, like, generally. But treat people well and respect other people's culture. That's the way I feel.
When if a player is getting ready to come out of the closet, and it was significant that he did, and, you know, the next phase will be there'll be a player who's got a more illustrious career will come out. Does a player come to a general manager and say, I'm thinking of doing this, walk me through it? What do you think the system is?
I don't know. I think maybe not the general manager, because obviously somebody like this is going to go to, I think, other people first, because you might not have that relationship, you know, like, yeah. I might not have that relationship with that certain player like that. So I think it will start with maybe going to a couple other people. Yeah. But the guy is brilliant. He's a class act, you know, like, and this is who he is, you know, like, and hey, I think more grease to his elbows, because I think the NBA has done, Adam Silver and even David Stern before he left, they've really handled this thing, I think, the way it should be, and really embraced it the way it should be.
Do teams have to talk to their management, talk to their players about creating a more open environment, an environment that's better, a more inclusive environment? Because sports dressing rooms are the least inclusive places generally. Mm-hmm. And sometimes in fun, but often not. How do you change that in your culture?
I think you instill that from, I think from, one, the kind of people you hire around, you know, like the way they deal with people. And it's funny, you know, like, it's the same meeting I had with Terrence Ross today, is how comfortable are you, you know, like, how you comfortable telling this person this thing, or is there anything that anybody has made you feel uncomfortable? And he said he loves it, you know, like, everybody, you include family, you know, I think it's a big part of it, because when their families of the players feel comfortable, then the players too feel comfortable. So it's something you have to instill. That's what we try to do, you know, like, from day one. And you can't just come and preach it in a room to people sitting down there. You have to show with actions, too. Sure.
Stick around. More with GM Masai Ujiri next. We're back here with Masai Ujiri, the man who's helped turn the Raptors around with a bunch of players. Okay, there's a bunch of things I want to ask you about. I should know this. But I know his first name, Giannis. Mm-hmm.
Adetokounmpo.
Right, this kid, Greek and Nigerian player, amazing. He's an okay player. He's a good player.
Yes.
But people love this kid.
because he represents this kind of wide-eyed, good fun. I can't believe I'm playing basketball for a living.
No doubt.
Yeah, and you know him, right?
Yes.
Didn't you?
In fact, we're not allowed to talk about other people's players, but the NBA helps me a little bit with the African players, and I consider him an African player, even though he was born in Greece and grew up there. But we just hosted his mom and dad. What a freak family, unbelievable, you know, like athletes. And you should see the 11-year-old and the 14-year-old. They're incredible already, like the way they look. But yeah. This kid just played and played and played. We went to watch him in Greece, and, you know, like teams went to watch him. And he has a chance to be really special.
And it matters, right? Athletes that people want to not be embarrassed about liking. Athletes who don't like, you see it every now and then in any sport. One football player is on trial for murder. Another, a basketball player brings a gun to a dressing room. That's just bad shit.
Well, when you, for me, you tell the players that this is an opportunity in a lifetime. It's going to go, one day is going to go, you know, like, and what impact are you making? The best way to be is to be real, you know, like, and it's the only way, in my opinion. You have to be real and real to yourself. And the guys that do that and figure it out, you know, like, they're pretty successful.
All right, anthropology time. Rapid fire questions. You ready for this?
Uh-oh.
Okay, what was the first fact that you ever learned about Canada?
That it's cold.
Who's the best soccer player in the NBA?
Luol Deng.
You can play, right? All right, if there was a battle of NBA mascots, I think it would come down to the Raptors versus the Grizzlies, who are now in Memphis, right?
Yes.
Why are Canadian teams' mascots so tough?
Because Canadians are tough.
We have to be. All right. Listen, this is going to sound, the question I'm going to ask you is going to sound like it's a joke question, but it's not. Do the marijuana laws in Colorado mean that Denver's going to have a way easier time attracting free agents? And because of this, will the Seattle finally get a team?
I'm getting a buzz in my phone here saying, cut, don't answer.
Dude, think about this, though. It's like, it's allowed by the league. Mm-hmm. What's the one character trait that you don't like to see in a potential draft candidate?
Lazy.
As a player?
Yes. Yeah. As a player, just lazy. You hate to see where they don't have this, and they have to be kickstarted. You have to jumpstart them. It's not, a lot of times, it's not a good sign.
You almost can't coach passion, right?
Yes.
When you go to sleep at night, do you leave your email alerts on, or do you shut your phone off?
Phone is on 24/7.
Yeah. The NBA officiating, I know you can't comment on it because you'll get fined, but...
You have enough money to give me.
No.
I work
at the CBC. The NBA officiating to me sometimes feels like I'm watching boxing in the 60s. It's so bad. But would Nelson Mandela have been able to keep his cool at the NBA Finals?
I met Nelson twice, and I'd say no.
He believes in justice. It would be so bad. What's the best basketball movie ever made?
Pardon me, say that again?
The best basketball movie you've ever seen.
Come Fly With Me.
That's the
best one. I don't know if lots of people saw it, but it's Kevin Bacon going back to Africa and recruiting that kid from Kenya, and they're playing basketball in a village on these courts and had numbers in their jerseys. Incredible. And he ended up being a recruit, and he ended up playing basketball for real at a school in California. But one of the best ones I saw.
I don't know how you answer this, but I'm going to ask it to you anyway. What do you do with the Vince Carter legacy? You walk around any franchise and you see numbers on the wall, and Vince Carter gets booed when he comes here, called him Vince the Wince. We loved him, and then we turned on him, for good reason, I think.
Mm-hmm.
How do you bring a guy like Vince back to this? Do you?
Mm-hmm. Well, I think, you know, like, I hate the notion of, I'm going to talk from both sides of my mouth here, pardon me, but I hate the notion of guys leaving and then at the end of their careers, you know, like, okay, you know, can I come back and forgiven and blah, blah, blah. Vince is, for me, is different, you know, like, and I think he He's one of the symbols of the Toronto Raptors, whether we like it or not. Yes, he left, and yes, there were issues at that time. You know, like all these young players coming up, they grew up watching Vince Carter. So I'm not allowed to talk about other people's players in that way, but, you know, like I think our organization,
yes.
After in our organization, I think we do respect him. I think Tim met with him. I wasn't in town. Tim met with him the last time they came into town with Mark Cuban's permission, and I think it went well, you know, like, and we've shown him that, well, we're trying to show him that, you know what, this is new, this is open thinking, and, you know, like, in the future, you know, like, we're definitely going to think openly.
What a real pleasure to talk to you. Thank you for your time, sir.
Thank you so much for having me.
President and General Manager of the Toronto Raptors, Masai Ujiri. Always a pleasure being with you. Good things, people.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.